Welcome to worship. Come to God who gathers us in. We come to God who loves us like a father. Come to God whose arms are open and waiting. We come to God who welcomes and forgives us. Come to God who journeys with us. We come to God who sees us as we are and loves us regardless. Come, let us praise our loving and wonderful God.
That saved a wretch.
Holy God, at whom we call Father, we give you thanks for the people who have been our earthly fathers in this life. And we pray for all sorts and conditions of fathers. For fathers who have striven to balance the demands of work, marriage, and children with an honest awareness of both joy and sacrifice. For fathers who, lacking a good role model, have worked to become a good father. For fathers who, by their own account, were not always there for their children, but who continue to offer those children now grown their love and support. For fathers who have been wounded by the neglect and hostility of their children. For fathers who, despite the divorce, have remained in their children's lives. For fathers whose children are adopted and whose love and support has offered healing. For fathers who, as stepfathers, freely chose the obligation of fatherhood and earned their stepchildren's love and respect. For fathers who have lost a child to death and continue to hold the child in their heart. For those men who have no children but cherish the next generation as if they were their own. For those men who have fathered us in their role as mentors and guides. For those men who are about to become fathers, may they openly delight in their children. And for those fathers who have died, but live on in our memory and in the communion of your saints, whose love continues to nurture us. And now let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we go back to the basics this summer, we are going to be studying in the book of Genesis. So last week we heard about Abraham and Sarah and how they had words from God about how they were going to have a child late in their years. They both laughed, of course, at this preposterous idea. But you know what? It seems so fitting that their son, who was named Isaac, which means laughter, because both of his parents laughed when they found out that they were going to have a child. Now, if you remember, before Abraham and Sarah had Isaac, they decided to expand their family through Hagar. Now, Hagar was Sarah's maid servant, and Hagar conceived quickly. And Sarah, although it was her idea for Abraham and Hagar to sleep together, she was angry that Hagar was able to conceive so easily and so quickly. Sarah then was so mean to Hagar that Hagar ended up fleeing into the wilderness while she was pregnant. And there, God appeared to her and told her that God was going to be with her, that God was going to bless her child, but she needed to go back to be with Sarah. And so she did, and when she had Ishmael, her son, Abraham was 86 years old. So now, at the time of our scripture, Isaac has been born, and Isaac now has been weaned. And so our scripture this morning is from Genesis 21, 9 through 21. But Sarah saw that the son whom Hagar the Egyptian had borne to Abraham was mocking. And she said to Abraham, "Get rid of that slave woman and her son, for that woman's son will never share in the inheritance with my son Isaac." The matter distressed Abraham greatly because it concerned his son. But God said to him, "Do not be so distressed about the boy and your slave woman. Listen to whatever Sarah tells you, because it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. I will make the son of a slave into a nation also, because he is your offspring. Early the next morning, Abraham took some food and a skin of water and gave them to Hagar. He set them on her shoulders and then sent her off with the boy. She went on her way and wandered in the desert of Beersheba. When the water of the skin was gone, she put the boy under one of the bushes. Then she went off and sat down about a bow shot away, for she thought, I cannot watch the boy die. And as she sat there, she began to sob. God heard the boy crying, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, What is the matter, Hagar? Do not be afraid. God has heard the boy crying as he lies there. Lift up the boy and take him by the hand, for I will make him into a great nation. Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. So she went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy as he grew up. He lived in the desert and became an archer. While he was living in the desert of Paran, his mother got a wife for him from Egypt. Ishmael in this scripture was probably about 17 years old. Remember, Abraham was about 86 when Ishmael was born, and then he was 100 when Isaac was born. So the scripture takes place after Isaac has been weaned, which would have been about the age of 3 back then that they would have weaned children. So Ishmael, the oldest brother, is playing with his younger stepbrother, Isaac. And Sarah sees this and is reminded that Ishmael is indeed the oldest son, and so she gets upset once again. As the oldest son, Ishmael would have been entitled to a double portion of the inheritance, and certainly would have occupied pride and place among Abraham's sons. Sarah wants Isaac to be in that place of power and privilege, not Ishmael. Abraham obviously loves Ishmael, so the idea of casting him away distresses Abraham. But God assures him that everything's going to be okay. So Abraham sends Hagar and Ishmael away with bread and water. And in the wilderness, once again, Hagar thinks that she and Ishmael are going to die. But the angel of God consoles her and consoles both of them and promises them success and that God will make a great nation of him. The story then fast forwards to Ishmael's success and his marriage. Now, if you look at the whole story of Abraham and Sarah and Isaac, this whole story of Father Abraham could have easily been told without the side story of Hagar and Ishmael. With their stories included, Sarah comes off sometimes as desperate and oftentimes mean. So why are Hagar and Ishmael included in this wonderful part of Scripture? I truly believe it's to show the great depth of love from God. The love from God that cares and encompasses all people. Hagar is an Egyptian slave girl. She has no status. She has no wealth. She has no land. She doesn't even have a husband. But rather, she was told to sleep with someone else's husband and then conceived. She has no community, no extended family, and no support system. Ishmael is Abraham's firstborn, but not from his wife. Ishmael, although he has the right to the firstborn perks, is denied them. He is forced to leave his home and when he is a teen. There's no support system for him either, except for his mom. He was cast away, discarded, an unwelcomed sight to Sarah, a social outcast. Yet God comes to Hagar twice in the wilderness to assure her that God is there and that God loves her, that God loves Ishmael. And in addition to all of that love, God promises that a great nation will come from Ishmael. Today, many Muslim Arabs refer to Ishmael as their people's ancestor. And even though greatness came for Ishmael and Hagar, they were, in the story of Abraham and Sarah and Isaac, the forgottens, the less thans, the social outcasts. This is the gospel message. You know, if we fast forward into the New Testament, the first four books of the New Testament are the gospels, all about Jesus. And right here in Genesis, we hear the gospel message. God's love is for all. God hears people's cries, sees their suffering, and brings redemption. In the Gospels, we see God through Jesus coming to the less thans, the social outcasts, the forgotten. Jesus heals the man with unclean spirits and the leper and the lame and the blind and the bleeding, brings back people from the dead, and bridges the gap between the lowly and the esteemed. In Genesis, we see God's love for all. And in the gospel that we read, God's love through Jesus comes out for all as well. God's love, from the very beginning of the Bible to the end, has no bounds. The invitation for us is to attend to and bless and embody God's love and care to all, particularly to those who are the most vulnerable. Right here, right now, what does that look like? To embody God's love for all might mean going to a peaceful protest. It might mean opening your eyes to the needs in your community. To the elderly, perhaps they need their lawn mowed, or to young families, they would be blessed by a meal. Or perhaps just a special treat to anybody, like from Grab a Cone. And when you approach someone about mowing their grass or bringing a meal, don't ask them, "When can I do this for you?" Because they will never call you. They never will. But rather say, "Hey, I'm gonna mow your grass this week. What day would be best?" Or, "Hey, this week I'm gonna bring you a meal. Which evening would be best?" Another way that we can embody God's love for all is wearing a mask. Now, I know some of you might think that that is a silly thing to say, but you know what? When we protect ourselves by wearing a mask, we are loving our neighbors and loving all. So as you go out and are with people that you don't know, just put your mask on. And then you're showing God's love for all. So just as God loves the Hagars and the Ishmaels of the world, so should we. May we go. May we be God's hands and feet. May we be love. Amen.
When peace like a sendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. It is well. is nailed to the cross, and I bear.